It's now time for Talkin' Boxing with Billy C. It began as a podcast, went live on the net, and transformed into a full-blown empire. Across the web, on Fight Now TV, and on radio stations around the world. It's the only daily boxing talk radio show on the planet, hosted by the only guy with the balls to do it. Many have stepped into the ring. Many have tried to take the belt. And one by one, they've fallen. Another victim of the undisputed heavyweight champion of boxing talk radio. Talkin' Boxing with Billy C is on now.
My style is impetuous, my defense is impregnable, and I'm just ferocious. I want your heart.
And we're coming to you live from the Billy C studio in Lake George, New York. I'm Bill Caligiuri. It's time for Talkin' Boxing with Billy C. Good morning, good day, good evening. Whenever you listen, I hope you're doing all right. We got a busy show scheduled for today, like we always do. We do. You know, we keep it going, man. But first, the show's being brought to you in part by Cats Nationwide Luxury Transportation Service. That's right. If you're looking for a limo and you're someplace in the United States, or even Canada, and you want a really hottie driving around, well, you need to give Cats Nationwide Luxury Transportation Service a call. 202-351-7496. Give Cat a call. Tell her Billy C sent you, but just remember, she's my girl. The show is also being brought to you in part by Campanero and Tomkovich. You're looking for a lawyer. Use the ones that keep my ass out of trouble. That is Campanero and Tomkovich. Give them a call today, 845-221-4099. 845-221-4099. Let Campanero and Tomkovich knock out your legal problem. The show is also being brought to you in part by my friends down at the Halftime Bar and Grill, Route 9, South Glens Falls, New York. Hey, man, if you like cool people to hang with, drink specials all the time, live entertainment on Friday and Saturday nights, and delicioso food, then you're going to love the Halftime Bar and Grill, Route 9, South Glens Falls. Call ahead for a reservation or directions, 518-792-4869. 518-792-4869. And the show is also being brought to you in part by ringside.com. That's right. There's only one place for your boxing equipment needs. That's ringside.com. Check them out right now, www.ringside.com. Tell them Billy C sent you. Demand a Billy C discount. And don't forget, for everybody out there that buys boxing equipment in bulk, you need to drop me an email, billy@talkin, T-A-L-K-I-N, B-O-X-I-N-G, .com, and I'll be able to get you even a bigger and a better discount. Just email me what you're looking to get. So, hey, ringside.com, one place to go. Busy show, like I said, coming up in a little bit. We got Daxx Khan. Speaking of Daxx Khan, the latest installment, everybody's been busting my you-know-whats about the New York State Athletic Commission versus Bryant Pappas situation. Well, I don't even know if it should be like that, but it's the Bryant Pappas situation. The next segment, the next piece, the next part, all of those things are up on the website right now, www.billycboxing.com. You can check it out for now on the front page. Or you can go into Daxx Khan's column for the latest on that one. Interesting stuff. It was very captivating for me this morning as I was reading it when I was supposed to be posting it. So anyway, check that one out. Also, coming up on the show a little bit later, we're going to dig deep into the heavyweight boxing history with Tony Treem's Heavyweight Spotlight. We're going to be talking about a guy that, both Tony and I talked on the phone several times leading up to this, and very limited information on former heavyweight world-ranked contender Elmer Ray. So we'll be talking about this guy. This guy fought after Joe Louis, around the Joe Louis time, and before his shot at like a Rocky Marciano. So he's in that in there. Chatty Factory just popped in, and this guy keeps telling me he's going to send me a link to a fight he wants me to watch from back in the day, and you haven't sent it yet, Chatty. You know, I mean, the one time you got it through to me, it didn't work, and since then I've never gotten it. Even yesterday in the chat room, he said, "I'm going to send you the link," and I never got it yesterday. You better check your email. Make sure it's talking, TalkinBoxing. Don't put the G in talking. But anyway. Here's what we got going on, some emails, and as I glance through these, I'm taking a beating today, so let's get it started. Hawk Mustang, Says, if you see great skill from Jack Dempsey and Jack Johnson, then I see greatest skill from the Klitschko brothers and Lennox Lewis. Plus, these guys do have height and strength and reach and weight advantage. Vlad and Lewis have somewhat suspect chins, so without defensive skills, they would be bums getting knocked out all of the time. Vitaly has good skill and also a good chin. Dempsey beat big Jess Willard, who was 6'6", 83-inch reach, and zero skills. The Klitschko brothers and Lewis would knock him out in one round. I don't know, man. I'm not going to keep beating this horse. Whatever. I do agree, and this is Hawks, is I do agree that Lennox Lewis and Klitschko brothers make good use of their size and reach to win. And that's my point. My point is, you know, I'm not knocking these guys. You guys turn this around like I'm saying that they're not quality fighters. All I'm saying is that, you know, the fighters of yesteryear, some of them, based on the level of opposition that was around, even though it's not fair to put, and I don't put the Klitschko brothers, I don't tell you, oh, they're not good because they're not fighting anybody. I don't say that. But in a dream, if you were able to go back in time, when you do look at other eras and you see the collection of talent, and then you still take those top guys, you would have to assume that they are better skilled. As far as skill set, listen, man, if you don't see skill set, I can understand about Jack Johnson because people don't understand. He was a pioneer with what we call the sweet science today. So you may look at him as being boring and everything else, but he's the guy. Like, for all these sweet science fans that throw that in my face, you know, if you knew about the history of the sweet science, you would know that Jack Johnson was one of the pioneers. And I'm not saying pioneer like bare knuckle when they called sweet science. I'm talking about what we know as the sweet science today, what we refer to as the sweet science. Jack Johnson was a pioneer in that. He was a guy that used his jab and poured and set up shots, you know. So, I mean, if you're looking at the primitive way he did it, well, he was a pioneer. I mean, a lot of guys that came after him tried to emulate him. So you need to give him the credit, but whatever. You know, if you think that the Klitschko brothers possess more skill set than a Jack Dempsey, and I keep using Jack Dempsey as an example because he was small, and he did possess other skills in addition to the killer instinct, which is also something I wish all three of those guys had. But I think Hawk hits it on the Mustang. Hawk hits it on the nose here about and that's been my whole point. I believe that these guys became very proficient at utilizing their height and reach advantage. You know, you knock Hawk knocks Jess Willard, but the truth of the matter is that Jess Willard did not know how to utilize his height and speed. If you listen to a guy like Teddy Atlas, he'll even tell you, and he talks about it during the fights, you know, a smaller guy, he wants to become smaller. A larger guy, he wants to become larger. You know, there's reasons for that. You know, there's reasons. And I believe that the Klitschko brothers and Lennox Lewis, especially the Klitschkos, have become very proficient at utilizing their size and actually making them bigger and harder to fight. But nonetheless, he says, you know, if you took away their height and reach, you take away their best weapons. That's my point. I agree with you. Hawk is saying it right here. If you take away their height and reach, you take away their best weapons. Exactly. You know, that's my point. But you still have a bogus argument. Why? Why do I have a bogus argument when you admit yourself that if you take away their size and height, you know, their size and reach advantage away, that you know, you don't have a... Now, granted, you could say, well, then you take away the fighter. And I'm just saying, my point is if you put them back in time, you would have to retain their height, okay? You'd have to retain their height. The only time you take away their height is if you put them in the pound-for-pound category. That's all. So, whatever. He says, if you took away... look at Roy Jones Jr. If you take away his best weapons, which was his speed and reflexes, you end up with a bum getting knocked out. No, but I wouldn't have taken away... whatever. He says, I don't think heavyweights belong in the pound-for-pound list. They are already on top. That I agree. So me and Hawk agree there. We agree on that one. EQX, he says, Floyd a non-issue, LOL. Robert and Paulie are both mediocre competition. He's talking about Robert Guerrero and Paulie Malignaggi. The fact is that there is not much competition. Oh, there is. That's okay. It's there, T-H-E-R-E, not there as in their house. But the fact is that there is not much competition at 147. What? There's not much competition at 147? What are you talking about, man? 147 is chock full of competition. I mean, you look at the welterweight. You got Timothy Bradley, Juan Manuel Marquez, Manny Pacquiao, Kell Brook, The Ghost, Josito Lopez, Devon Alexander, Paulie Malignaggi, Victor Ortiz, Andre Berto. That's our top 10. That's our top 10. What are you talking about? There's no competition. If you're referring to Floyd, okay, I'll take that. You know, Floyd's been there, done that. Floyd doesn't need to fight all those young guys. Floyd's looking for a handful, two more fights, you know. And I like to fight with Guerrero. I like it. I think it's a good fight for Guerrero. I think it's a good fight for Floyd. He says, let's see, 147. When Floyd beats Guerrero and Canelo, I wonder what the excuse will be. What excuse? You know, he says, Canelo is a robot in the ring who is one-dimensional, and that's why they haven't put him in with the ring with top competition. I agree. And I think Floyd will destroy Canelo. You know, I just think that Robert de Ghost Guerrero is going to be a tougher fight for Floyd. I never said he was going to beat him. I said it was a tougher fight for Floyd. You know, so what are you talking about? There's no excuses. You don't have to make an excuse for Floyd. We know his MO. We know he's at the end. This isn't a guy coming up. This isn't Canelo. You know, this isn't a guy that's coming up that has to prove himself. Floyd has to prove himself to no one. All right, so I don't know what you're saying here, EQX. I don't get it. I agree with you that Canelo is an easier robotic fighter for Floyd. He says, I'm looking forward to seeing Gamboa fight. He's exciting to watch, much like Pacquiao, a warrior who's not afraid to let his hands go. I agree. I agree with that. You know, let's just hope he's not busted on the juice.
If you're in upstate New York and you need a trucking company, then you need Roselli Enterprises. Roselli Enterprises is trucking at its finest. They have it all. Dump trucks, dump trailers, walking floors, flatbeds, flow boys, tankers, loaders, and a full line of roll-off containers for any job, big or small. Roselli Enterprises is also the source for all your sand, gravel, and topsoil needs. Visit them on the web at RoselliTrucking.com or call 315-433-5115. That's 315-433-5115 and tell them Billy C sent you.
Are you ready, America? Then let's get it on with Fight Now TV. It's time, fight fans. Your channel has arrived. All the fights, all the names, all the action. From world-class boxing events to mixed martial arts showdowns and other combat sports matchups, Fight Now TV delivers the hits and more. Call your television provider and tell them you want to get it on with Fight Now TV. For more details, go to fightnow.com.
We've got a great matchup tonight. Fighting out of the left corner is the number one ranked contender.
No, he is not.
I'm sorry, but who are you?
I am the IBO computer. I am programmed to provide only fair and unbiased boxing rankings. This fighter is the number 15 ranked contender.
Fair and unbiased boxing rankings? That's a new concept.
Actually, it is not. The IBO has provided unbiased computerized rankings for many years.
Well, we've still got a great fight tonight, folks. In the left corner is the number 15 ranked contender.
The IBO, the champion of integrity. Learn more at IBOboxing.com.
Check out BillyCBoxing.com now, or feel the wrath of the mighty mustache.
Oh, that hurts! Why are you doing that to my face? I hate you. I hate you.
That's BillyCBoxing.com. Consider this your warning.
As a young boy, all Billy C dreamed about was one day having his own catchphrase.
And we're back. And we're back.
One boy, one dream, one day, everyone will say.
And we're back. 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 And we're back.
Catchphrase coming soon. store near you.
And we're back. You're listening to the Talking Boxing with Billy C Show. You know, this weather is crazy here. You know, I've been crying the blues about how cold it's been, right? Well, yesterday it warmed up to like 40 degrees. And today all it's doing is raining profusely. I wouldn't be surprised if the studio goes dark because the power companies around here aren't that good. You know, I think their generator is basically smoke signals. So anyway, we're reading some emails. I'm taking a beating already this morning. I hope it doesn't get worse, but glancing here, it looks like it may. Jack Dempsey nor Jack Johnson couldn't even beat Tommy Morris. Come on. Morrison would knock them out 9 out of 10 times. Go back and we'll look at both Dempsey and Johnson's footage. They look like low-quality MMA fighters throwing haymaker punches. He says, I'm just saying, guys. I don't have a comment. Tommy Morrison, come on. Come on, man. Biggieback says, I get what Hawk is trying to tell you about over-glorifying past fighters. And you do have extreme favoritism for past fighters. Even if you have a boxer today who follows old-school blueprint like Bernard Hopkins does, and doesn't duck the biggest threats, you still claim Hurricane Carter is better than Beyond, for example. You know, he says, for a simple fact that he was an older, and that's it. Even though he didn't beat anybody, he wasn't supposed to like B-Hop and did the skills and come on, blah, blah, blah. He says, you just favor the older fighters over the current ones, no matter what the case is, and downplay his accomplishments by saying he's a Hall of Famer for his longevity and defense. That's what I said about B-Hop. That's what he's saying. When the truth is, it's because, like your heroes, he's the best. He beat the best guys and beat the guys he wasn't supposed to beat, just like Ali and Duran did. You know, here's the thing. You know, I think Biggieback is he's got the wrong picture, but the right idea. Here's the thing. I've said this before, and I'll say it again. We all have a tendency to look back at previous eras and think that they were better than the one we were in. We don't give the credit to the era you're in until after it's over. And I'm not saying that's right. I'm not saying it's right, but it's a fact. And if you look at it, this is why I don't like to talk about Hall of Fame fighters while they're still fighting. You know, Bernard Hopkins, I've admitted, and I've come clean a little bit about, I've come around a little bit about Bernard Hopkins. I've admitted that, you know, I put a lot of my anti-Bernard Hopkins, my feeling about Bernard Hopkins outside of the ring, in front of some of his skill set, but based on some of the comments that you guys have gotten to me, including Biggieback, I've changed my stance on Bernard. I still don't like the person that I see portrayed. I've never talked with him outside the ring, but the person I see portrayed, I don't get respect. I do, blah, 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 blah. You know, that's the guy I'm not crazy about. But I will admit that Biggieback is 100% correct. Bernard Hopkins has never backed away from a fight. You know, I never said he did. You know, he's fought at a high level. I just don't think he's exciting, and I'm curious to see why. I'm curious to know why people still watch him. But I do believe that he's a quality fighter. So I think you might got me. I think you have me a little wrong there. As far as Hurricane Carter. You know, Hurricane Carter was a good fighter, man. I mean, the problem with Hurricane was a lot of not putting fighting first. You know, he was involved in some other things, but you know, when he was at his best, he was an extremely talented fighter. Is he a Hall of Famer and all that stuff? No, but I did have him in my all time great only because of some of the devastating shots that I've witnessed with him on footage and stuff like that. So. But your point is taken, Biggieback. Given quality, my man, given quality says, the Klitschkos duck each other, Billy C. Today's youth is just sick of the old school nuthuggers, I guess that's right, blindly supporting everything skills and flaws of old fighters and trying to convince today's young people that they're far better than today's elite fighters. When judging their resumes, they're trying to be questionable opponents and excuses that glossed over. I would be fine with that if you judge today's fighters with the same merit. But no, you factor in anything and everything to discredit this era. It's a conflict of interest. You are 100% wrong, given quality. I do not discredit this era. I only discredit the paths in which fighters take to get a trinket belt. And unfortunately, the fighters of yesteryear used to all compete for one belt in every division. Well, and you got to put an asterisk next to that because there were other belts, okay, but not to the degree of today. That's my overall biggest pet peeve. You know, when you had a top 10 contender back prior to you know, 1975, when you had a top 10 contender, generally he was one of 10. Now you have a top 10 contender who could be one of 50. One of 50 for the same weight class. All 50 of them ranked in top 10, you know, if you take the top five. You know, and as far as criticizing the young fighters, here's my rankings. This is the Billy C rankings, right? Not mine, but our panel, right? I'm just going to quickly go down and tell you who I think is a quality fighter out of our top 10, who I think is a quality fighter that I think is a good fighter. And this is where I'm going to prove you wrong, where I don't, you know, give credit to today's young fighters. My point about the heavyweights was only in the heavyweight division. My point about Floyd Mayweather was only about Floyd ducking fighters that were available to him. That's it. You can't really say anything else. Bernard Hopkins, different situation. Larry Holmes, different situation. That's it. I think I covered everyone that I'm criticized about. All right? Heavyweights. Vladimir and Vitaly both are quality fighters. No question about it. Cruiserweight division, Marco Huck, Denis Lidovev, both quality fighters. No problem. All right? Light, and I'm not saying the rest of them aren't. I'm just saying these are the top guys in the division, in my opinion. Light heavyweight, I like. I do like Bernard Hopkins. I like Chad Dawson. I don't think he's as good as people think. I think Tavorius Cloud is underrated. I like Bibot Shumanov. I think he's underrated. I think the light heavyweight division has got a lot of talent. Super middleweight, you know, it might be easy to say who I don't like, but Andre Ward, Carl Froch, I still like Boutte. I like Arthur Abraham. All quality fighters. Georgie Groves, all quality. Middleweight, Sergio Martinez, Chavez Jr., Triple G, all quality fighters. You know, Haseem Nadam the Jam, I like him. You know, I like Nadam. I think he's good, you know, even though he lost. I like what I saw with Demetrius Andrade last week, you know, so I like that. Junior middleweight, you know, we have Floyd ranked in junior middleweight because he hasn't fought since. I like Floyd as a junior middleweight. I think he's a quality fighter. Saul Alvarez, quality fighter. You know, I like Jesus Soto Carras, quality fighter. You know, I've always said he was good. Welterweight, you know, Bradley, Juan Manuel Marquez, Manny Pacquiao, Robert De Goes Guerrero, Josito Lopez, Devon Alexander, Andre Berto, all quality fighters. I like them all. You know, junior welterweight, Danny Garcia, Lucas Matisse, Amir Khan, Lamont Peterson, Brandon Rios, Mike Alvarado. Like them all. Like them all. Think they're all quality fighters, man. You know, lightweight, Ricky Burns, Adrian Bronner, who will incidentally become an elite fighter. I'm going to get to the elites in a second. You know, Antonio DeMarco, Sharif Bogery, all fighters I absolutely love. I like them all. Junior lightweight, Takashika Yuchimaya, I like him. You know, no question about it. I like Gamboa. You know, I like Gamiel Diaz. You know, Diego Magalhães. I love that kid. You know, got to meet him and hang out with him. He's a great kid. You know, I think they're all quality. Featherweight, Miguel Garcia, Danny Ponce de Leon. You know, I still think Orlando Salido is a quality fighter. Johnny Gonzalez, Gary Russell Jr., another fighter I love that will become an elite fighter soon. Junior Feather, Rigondeaux, Nonito Donaire, Abner Mares, Victor Chinian, Carl Frampton, all quality fighters in my opinion. Bantamweight, Leo Santa Cruz, Agbeko, Jorge Arce, all quality fighters, in my opinion. You know, I also like junior bantamweights, Omar Navarez. You know, I like him. The junior bantamweight division, I think, is a little weak, to be honest with you. Flyweights, I love Brian Valora, Hernan Marquez. Junior flyweight, El Chocolito, Gonzalez, you know, Ulysses Solis, John Real Casimiro. You know, all quality fighters, man. All quality fighters. How can you say I don't like the fighters of today? You know, I'm going down the list. I'm looking at them real quick, you know. Strawweight, Moses Fuentes, like him. You know, Juan Palacios, like him. Denver Cuello, like him. All quality fighters. You know, when you look at elite, you know, today's elite fighters, look at our top 10. Our pound-for-pound top 10. Look at them. That's who I think. I agree with our top 10. They are the only elite fighters that I would call elite. Elite. Not quality. Not good. Not that I don't like them. Elite. Andre Ward, Sergio Martinez, Floyd Mayweather, Juan Manuel Marquez, Manny Pacquiao, Nonito Donaire, Carl Froch, Timothy Bradley, Vladimir Klitschko. Yes. Yes, he's an elite fighter. And I don't know about these number 10 we have tied for Miguel Cotto, Robert Guerrero. I don't know about those. Put an asterisk next to them. But the other nine, all elite. All elite, man. You know, so, I don't know what else to tell you. You know, I mean, they're quality fighters. You know, so I think I'm getting a bad rap. And you know, I just want to back something up here real quick. And Daxx Khan is going to be joining us here in a couple of minutes. He's going to be joining us at the top of the hour. But I want to back something up, something that maybe you guys don't understand. Now, Henry Haskup is our trivia question provider. This is a guy that provides our trivia questions. He's not only really proficient at trivia, but the guy finds all the information that I need. And he got some information. He said, and I quote, he said, "You were right when you talked about Dempsey and BoxRec." He says, "I happen to be one of the editors on BoxRec, but it's far from complete. When you see a fighter that has four, I don't understand this, but..." He says that when you see a fighter that has, maybe he meant fought as many fights, who has fought, I have no idea what he's trying to say, but it just means that there were fights that weren't found in papers. You know, he says, "I still have thousands of fighters to review." He says, "Most, if not all the old timers that saw Jack Dempsey fight thought he was the best. In 1950, the Sports Writers of America voted Jack Dempsey as the greatest fighter of all time. I talked to many, including Ray Arcel, who was a famous trainer, who told me that Dempsey was the best they ever saw. Dempsey was still rated number one in through the 60s, and then Lewis took over as the top dog by many of the boxing experts, but stayed that way for years. Now, in the last 50 years, here's what is listed. And in 1950, the AP sports writers had Jack Dempsey number one. In the greatest male athletes, including all sports, in 1950, had Jim Thorpe number one, Babe Ruth number two, Jack Dempsey number three, just to give you an idea. So, yeah, you know, I mean, this guy was the real deal. I mean, you got to give him credit. And I'm not taking anything away from the Klitschkos. I'm just saying that, you know, he did possess skill. You know, whatever. Contrary to what you may think, he did possess skill. Hey, listen, we're going to take a short break. When I come back, we're going to have Daxx Khan on. Now, Daxx is going to talk about the new segment that he just put up, the new part that he just put up, I should say, on the Bryant Pappas situation with the New York State Athletic Commission. Coming up in a little bit, I got... Some boxing results that took place yesterday in from the land down under. We had the match between Daniel Giel and Anthony Mundine. We also got it signed, sealed, and delivered. The rematch for two fighters I absolutely love, Bam Bam Rios and Mike Alvarado. Also, my man Tyson Fury made a pretty bold statement about the Klitschkos. He says they're bad for boxing. There's rumors that Ricky Hatton is going to fight in MMA for the UFC. I got some contradicting information on that. All of that's coming up in about two.
Are you ready, America? Then let's get it on with Fight Now TV. It's time, fight fans. Your channel has arrived. All the fights, all the names, all the action. From world-class boxing events to mixed martial arts showdowns and other combat sports matchups, Fight Now TV delivers the hits and more. Call your television provider and tell them you want to get it on with Fight Now TV. For more details, go to fightnow.com.
Broadcasting in all corners of the globe, on the web and radio.
He would scoff at a stretch of that man, I would think.
You're listening to Talkin' Boxing with Billy C. From upstate New York in the good old U.S. of A.
Boxing is here to stay because we are here to stay.
The best 2 hours of boxing talk on the airwaves.
Hey, fight fans, check out KOFantasyBoxing.com. KO Fantasy Boxing is boxing's only trademarked fantasy game. Check it out, www.KOFantasyBoxing.com. Select your own gym, your own fighters, track them through a season that can last from 3 months to a year, depending upon which league you join. You got to check this out, man. www.KOFantasyBoxing.com. Join it today. Again, www.KOFantasyBoxing.com. And tell them Billy C sent ya.
Now back to Talkin' Boxing with Billy C, the only radio host man enough to take a punch from Mike Tyson.
Wait a minute, man. Hold on there. Jeremy, man, I need you to take this one, all right?
Wait, what? No way. I can't do this.
Need I remind you I'm Billy C, damn it? Now put on that mustache and get in there.
Hey, look at me. I'm Billy C. Crap.
The undisputed heavyweight champion of boxing talk radio. It's Talkin' Boxing with Billy C.
Test one, two. My fellow Americans, good evening. Welcome back to Talkin' Boxing with Billy C. It's great to be here discussing the sweet science with everybody. I love boxing. I love talking boxing. It's what I do.
Bill.
Wait, what? Why are you interrupting me?
Wrong.
What's
wrong,
the problem?
Billy
what?
C.
I did not have...
We're going to have to ask
wrong
you.
Speech. What do you mean wrong, Billy C? What's going on here? Fine, I'll go. I just wanted to talk some boxing on TPSradio.net. That's all I wanted to do. I don't need your damn show. I'll get my own talking wrestling with the other Billy C. Yeah, that sounds good. Yeah, I've always been a Hulkamaniac anyway.
Broadcasting live, brother. Welcome back to Talkin' Boxing with Billy C on the mighty TPSradio.net, brother. What you gonna do, brother?
Thanks, Hulk. Appreciate it, man. You're listening to the Talkin' Boxing with Billy C show. You're watching us on the Fight Now television channel. Glad you could join us. And I just want to make a quick statement. You know, Chatty Factory's in the chat room right now. No, he didn't come up with that handle for our chat room, but it does match him well. He said, you know, if anyone wants to look up Benny Leonard, there's no way that anyone could say that there's a fighter of today that possesses the same boxing skill that he did. You just don't see that kind of skill anymore. Benny Leonard was actually, you know, talk about sweet science. A lot of people think that, you know, Muhammad Ali and all these guys, you know, who they emulated, Sugar Ray Robinson and all of this. But the guy who Sugar Ray Robinson emulated was Benny Leonard. So, I mean, you want to talk about a guy that possessed skill that a lot of you young whippersnappers just don't remember anymore. It's Benny Leonard. It's Benny Leonard. Speaking of young whippersnappers, joining us right now, Daxx Khan. What's up, brother?
Good morning. How is everybody?
Talk to us, man. Talk to us. I read your new part. It's up on the website. It's in your column. It's up on the front page. Interesting stuff. It sounds like you got a lot of things going on. Is there anything you could talk to us about?
there is a lot of things going on. You know, my original title for that article was actually going to be, you know, Every Man for Themselves, Abandoned Ship, because it just seems the more as time goes on, and of course, it just, you know, when something occurs and something happens, you start realizing other things more. You know, they just become more evident. You know, since I started with this series, more and more people just really have issues with NYSAC. And since the first installment, either people have been claiming fabrication, like I wrote in the article, or that, or, you know, everybody just wants to point a finger at NYSAC themselves, that something that NYSAC did to them. You know, it's only a matter of time before, you know, one of those people says enough. You know, for Governor Cuomo to have to look at that, you know, that current staff, and it's going to happen soon.
Well, there's no doubt that the current people that are involved with the commission have run their course. I mean, it's like you know, I hear it all the time, you know, about this particular regime, you know, their interests are it seems to me anyway. This is my opinion. That their interests are beyond what their job description is. You know, they're supposed to be looking out for the safety of the fighters and all the participants in the sport of boxing, and at the same time promote the sport of boxing in New York State. And I personally feel that they do not do that. Now, with your story, your report, I should say, I believe that it's a cut and dry situation, just like, you know, you and I have talked. I believe that the New York State Athletic Commission made a mistake. And I think that everyone makes mistakes. But what separates a good, you know, in this case, sanctioning body, or in this case, a commission from a bad commission, is a commission that's able to stand up and be a man, so to speak, and say, hey, we made a mistake. We'll never do it again. We're going to have our rules in place. We're going to have our inspectors know that they got to look out for X, Y, Z, all these other things. But they've failed to do that. As far as I know, they haven't even talked to you, right?
They have not responded to any of my requests. Now, we've sent out 7 different requests, both to Ralph Petrillo and Melvina Latham's office, and they haven't responded at all whatsoever. And you're right. If somebody would just admit they made a mistake and they promised, or, you know, they, you know, gave the word that we're going to try harder to make sure that no such thing should happen, whether it be in this case or any, you know, they find that people in this, especially in this country, are very forgiving. I mean, this is a country that, you know, we love Marion Barry to smoke crack, get fired, and, you know, have his job back.
Exactly.
Jerry Springer was allowed to, you know, get, quote, prostitutes, lose his job as mayor of a major city, and he was reelected again. You know, this country is very forgiving if you just come out and you ask for the forgiveness. But this boxing commission that we have right now, they're not, they just don't even want to admit any fault. And by their not admitting fault, you know, it affects people's lives. It really does. And in this case, you know, it affects somebody's safety. But the point I was trying to make before, Bill, is that once, a lot of times, you know, it's kind of like when you were a kid in the schoolyard, you always had that one bigger kid, that big goofy kid who did nothing but pick on everybody, and when he came around, you know, you'd stop playing basketball, or you'd get up, you'd take your lunch, you'd go sit at another bench because nobody just wanted to be around him, but everybody was afraid of him. And then there was that one kid one day who stood up to him, then all of a sudden every other kid in the whole class and every other kid in the whole playground, they all stood right next to that kid because they all had enough of that big doof. And, you know, everybody's pretty much, they're having enough of NYSAC. If you listen to Teddy Atlas over the last month, and Teddy, we know, can be overly dramatical with some of his comments and responses, Teddy blasted NYSAC more than once in the last month. And the last card that was ESPN had here in New York, Teddy blasted Melvin Latham. Or it might have been the Showtime card, I'm sorry. I can't remember who it was now. I think it was during the Triple G fight. You know, they blasted Melvina Latham over there for, you know, for what took place, for allowing Gabriel Rosado to suffer that cut and stay there too long. Just things just continuously pop up. A lot of them are just little nagging ones, but they add up. You know, you can only keep pushing the buttons so many times before the machine breaks.
Well, you know, I love your analogy with the bully on the schoolyard, because that's how I look at the current New York State Athletic Commission. They're filled with a bunch of bullies. They think who they are. You see these overweight out of shape guys that are struggling to get up on the rope, hanging, pulling themselves on the rope. You know, they all got their little job there, wearing their badges. You know, my hang up with them is this, you know, and I agree with you. You know, if I'm in the commission, if I'm the commissioner, and one of my people made a mistake like this and didn't do their job and let, assuming that they, you know, let somebody put on a pair of gloves that you know, they didn't inspect or whatever, or didn't inspect the way they were supposed to, or didn't follow protocol, whatever the situation is, I would have reprimanded that particular person, and then I would have issued an apology, at least accepting the fact that we did something wrong. But rather than do that, rather than own up to it, rather than be a man, rather than show the boxing community that they're trying to protect everyone involved with the sport, they emphasize the fact that it's their baseball, they get to pitch. They play by their rules. They don't care what their rules say, because the rules are written so vaguely that the interpretation of them is like reading the Bible. You know, many people could read the same line and interpret things differently, and I think that that's the problem. My main question to you about this is this, Dax. If the New York State, just for hypothetical, if the New York State Athletic Commission, regardless of who it was, from the commission, you know, whether it be Melvina or Ralph Petrillo, which incidentally, you know, who is in charge? You know, technically it's supposed to be Melvina, but
Ralph's in charge of boxing. Melvina's in charge of the actual commission itself. People seem to forget that.
Oh, okay. So Ralph, at least with the support from Melvina Lathan, should at least have issued a statement. Now, let me ask you this. Does Bryant Pappas, is he just looking to get, you know, some kind of recognition from the commission that that something out of the rules or something wrong took place? What is the whole purpose of this? I mean, is this just to have the commission say, hey, we messed up, we're sorry, it won't happen again? Or is it, you know, undercovering other things that have been going on? You mentioned in your article threats. Are these threats that are coming to you, or are they being made to other people that are in the business from the commission or from anyone else? I you know, you didn't mention it, but can you talk about that now?
I did mention in that article exactly that how the idle threats were being sent to me, you know, between emails, social media, which can be the greatest or the most annoying thing in the face of the earth, but, you know, comments on social media, links to articles or to anything that we've put out there on our Twitter sites and accounts. And I've gotten phone calls at my house and on my cell phone, you know, both stating the same thing, you know, well, you know, you're treading dangerous waters here, and what's going to happen to you is, and then they'll give four or five different experiences of examples of other people, you're going to get blackballed from places. You know, maybe you don't want to step into this. You know, maybe you don't want to deal with this. You know, there is a few people from your commission that are awful close to your home base, aren't they? And they're idle threats. It's, you know, some of them, you know, maybe the people have true intentions. They mean what they say. And then other ones is just, you know, just people looking to stir the pot a little bit. But there have been threats made that, you know, not I would be blackballed. There's been, you know, some threats that I would be sued. And as I always say, you know, and I've said several times, and you know me, Bill, I always go through great lengths to make sure, you know, anything that I put out there is, if it's based on my opinion solely, I strictly say, you know, in my opinion solely. And what they could not understand is the many times I wrote in the first installment, based on evidence in my possession. I had this evidence in my possession. And if I say based on evidence in my possession, that means it's evidence in my possession. On my person. That's what Brandon Frazier, when I stated in this installment, Brandon was just, you're fabricating the tale. Diana Rodriguez said, this is bull. You're hurting Josh's career. Why would you say this? I need my chance to talk. And when I mentioned him, well, do you have anything different to say than what you told Mark Ortega, who conducted quite a few detailed audio interviews that I have? And he just totally wouldn't. He just got started fumbling over his words, and finally, I did, you know, but I didn't know that, you know, that was on record. I didn't know he was actually going to use that. And, you know, it's nothing about this is slandered. Nothing about this is made up, and everything about this is just starting. It's getting a snowball effect. A lot of people are jumping on the bandwagon for this, Bill, and the more people that jump upon this, you know, the better it's going to be for boxing. But just real quick, how you say interpretation, it's funny you mention that, because I was sent an email where somebody tried to change around the interpretation of Part 20945, you know, equipment supplied by the promoter for events in the New York State Athletic Commission rulebook. We talked about this one day off the phone. It says, in addition to the ring and equipment, the promoter shall supply the following items, which shall be available for use as needed. Gloves for each boxer in each contest or exhibition. Gloves shall not weigh less than 8 ounces, of which no more than 1 ounce shall be in the wrist padding of the glove. There's other parts inside the commission rule book that, you know, pretty much states the promoter has to be the supplier of the gloves. But there you go. You have interpretation. As needed. Available as needed. So there's an easy out right there. Brandon Frazier really didn't need Josh Williams really didn't need a pair of gloves. He had a pair of his own. When inspected, they were good.
Well, here's,
you know, how many times do we see, especially in big major title fights, guys, you know, they will, in their contract, down to that last detail of what pair of gloves they're going to wear, they'll negotiate it.
Exactly, and that's the main issue here, Dax, in my opinion. And unfortunately for Bryant Pappas, we're never going to know if those gloves were tainted or anything else. You know, when you look at it's amazing the photo from George Dominguez, who's up on the website right now, the photo. And when you look at that photo of Bryant Pappas, and then you look at the segment prior to that, which is right below it in your column, and you see the distortion of his face. I mean, it looks like somebody hit him with a bat. You know, I mean, it's unbelievable. But the bottom line is this. You know, the way it works, the protocol, and I'm sure that the ABC boxing rules would do this, and Tim Luckenbach, who's in charge of that, and any other, you know, reputable commissioner of a United States boxing commission would agree to this statement, what I'm going to say. You know, they're not all forced to wear the same exact gloves anymore due to those reasons, like you said, whether it be sponsorship, whether it's a comfort zone with the fighter or whatever. And commissions are allowed to introduce another, and I don't mean the commission themselves, it's not like they have a bag of gloves, I mean to let a fighter have his own glove with them or something like that. But the protocol is that they're supposed to bring it to the other fighter and say, listen, do you have a problem with this glove? Here it is, check it out. You know, and then the other fighter either says, yes, I have a problem, or no, I don't. Or in most cases, they'll say, well, I want to wear those gloves too. Do you have another pair? That is the step that the New York State Athletic Commission skipped. And that's where they're at fault. They made a mistake. That is the bottom line mistake. Now, everything else that has fallen into place after this is just a compounded snowball effect of their incompetence. And that's the word I like to use. I believe that this current New York State Athletic Commission is incompetent. You know, I look at a commission as being a representative for the state, not just for boxing. And, you know, they have to represent themselves as such. You know, and what people want to, New York already has a bad name. You know, we got the guys in the chat room talking about unsolved murders in New York. Everybody thinks it's a terrible state and everything else. Well, this doesn't help matters when you got a commission who thinks they are.
You're exactly right. You know, that's the I was almost going to use those exact words. They think who they are. My grandfather used to use that expression. You know, they do. They think who they are, and they feel entitled to do as they please. And that's what happens with any position, I believe, especially appointed positions, where there is not somebody overlooking you at all times, and you don't have somebody to constantly report to. The governor's office has more pressing things to concentrate on than, you know, whether or not Ralph Petrillo and Melvina Latham are making sure that boxers properly inspect that event.
Yeah, but wait a minute. The Governor Cuomo, who, you know, whatever, however you feel about him, the bottom line is he does have a commitment to New York State and the safety of licensed New York State boxers and any other licensed boxer that comes to this state and to compete in a professional boxing match. you know,
absolutely. That's absolutely. You know, 100%. I agree on that, and that's one of the goals, you know, of this series, and that's one of Bryant Pappas' goals, is to get Governor Cuomo's office over there to overlook things. But my point on that was, the governor's office has a lot more pressing issues than to take somebody away from what's currently going on in their offices, be it financial, criminal, whatever the case may be, and appoint them to oversee what Petrillo and Lathan are doing at every single event. Because you know what? Then you might as well just remove Petrillo or Lathan if you got to hire a whole new person to stand around and watch, guard dog them and make sure they're doing what they got to do.
They shouldn't.
Why do you have to hire somebody to go in the dressing room? Why would I have to go with Billy C into the dressing room to make sure Billy C is inspecting the gloves?
No, you're right about that. And I just think it's more evident that this regime, this group of people that are involved with the New York State Athletic Commission has run its course. It's time for them to leave. It's time to get new blood in there. Now, that whole process of who is a whole nother ball game. You know, I mean, that I'm not going to blame, Ralph Petrillo or Melvina Latham or anyone else that's involved with the commission now for getting the job. You know, they're lucky. They're just taking advantage of their position. And these other names you mentioned the matchmaker, Diana Rodriguez. You know, she's a someone who works with Ralph. You know, so you could start to see, some of these people that and the comments that they're saying, you know, maybe they don't want their gravy train to end, you know. And the bottom line is this: I've gotten a lot of calls and a lot of emails and a lot of correspondence about your piece and everything else. And the bottom line is this: there are many, and I would even go as far as saying most people that are licensed in New York State as a trainer or a whatever, a corner guy, somebody that holds a New York State boxing license of some sort, are very unhappy with this current commission, but they all don't want to have problems, so they keep their mouth shut. And I think you're right. I think this is shaking the pot a little bit, and they are starting to come forward, and they are starting to make statements. And I think the statement, the quote you got from Brian Burke, is an indication of that. Brian Burke, case people don't know, used to work with Tracy Patterson as a trainer, former world champion, and he's currently a boxing promoter out of upstate New York. And he made a statement in your article that is pretty cut and dry. He says, those weren't the gloves we brought. Those weren't the gloves that the New York State Athletic Commission inspected and gave us the okay. Don't know where they came from. Talk to the commission. Bam. I think it says it all.
When I asked him, you know, when I got on the phone, I identified myself with Brian. I gave a little brief overview on what was going on. And he seemed genuinely, bothered by it all. He got real, I asked him, about the gloves. And, he sat and he thought for a second. And he just replied, he goes, we did not provide those gloves. You know, we had Title Everlast. You know, Bryant's a great guy. I can't say enough about him as a person and the things he does. But, you know, I seen him afterwards, and he was covered with all those scratches, and it was kind of like he had a tone on him when somebody's disgusted with something, you know, kind of like that. You know, I just, how could that happen? I just don't get it. You know, he just seemed baffled by, obviously Bryant Pappas, his life wasn't in danger, but it was one of those things where it's just, this is ridiculous. And he made, specifically emphasized the fact that it really was an action-packed fight where you can say, it was from rough and tumble infighting and elbowing and, none of that was evident in that bout. And when a promoter is outing, saying, listen, that's who I would point at, and that's what he wanted to say, he's pointing at the commission. He answered he wouldn't talk any further. As I mentioned, he just wanted to double check to make sure that I wasn't from any trying to get any quotes for a law firm that might be helping Bryant Pappas. But he generally felt bad about what took place, and Brandon Frazier is generally confused. And my next installment, which will be out Friday, is going to be my entire conversation with Frazier, and in that conversation, Frazier mentioned how he was rushed. They were told to get on those gloves, get out there, or your fight's going to end up being canceled.
Yeah, that's their M.O.
But those fuel fight gloves, and he has no idea where they came from.
That's the M.O. of the New York State Commission. You know, hey, listen, you don't do what we say, that's it. You're out of here, man. We're going to cancel the show, cancel your fight, cancel this, cancel that. They abuse their power. It makes me sick. I just want to know one thing. I want you to make something perfectly clear to me and to all the viewers and the listeners out there. If the New York State Athletic Commission, whether it be Ralph, it feels like I'm going to throw up every time I say his name. You know how people used to say Ralph? They used to refer to throwing up as Ralph, you know. So, but anyway, you know, is it Ralph or Melvina Latham? If either one of them issued a statement today and it said, as a response to the May fight in 2012 in Poughkeepsie, New York, we acknowledge that we made an error in the inspection of the gloves. Blah, blah, blah. You know, we're not changing any results of the fights. We're not doing this, but we made an error. We'll look into it, and we're it's never going to happen again, period. Is that closure for Daxx Khan, and is it closure for Bryant Pappas?
Sure, it's closure. Then you know what? It explains how it happened, but what isn't closure is where did the gloves come from? You know, that's very, what people understand is that's very important because of the fact, not only, you know, because of this aspect, it's important for the fact that how many times, even not even in New York, you know, across the sport, how can people just get away with bringing their own gloves in? You know, who's not paying attention?
Well,
you know, and that's very important because that's how we've had, you know, and of course I'm not, you know, comparing this situation to the extent of, but that's how we had, you know, issues like the Colin Dresto about, and that's how we had incidences and big scandals, you know, such as what happened with Mosley and Margarito. Thank gosh that was caught before, you know, it went out there. And, you know, we had incidences from Marius Walk against Vladimir Klitschko, and that wasn't even in this country, where people have tried to use tainted gloves inside the dressing room. And Vitaly is the one who caught that. If anybody ever seen that video on YouTube, you talk about a scared group of individuals. Man, Vitaly Klitschko walking over, poking in that glove, and when that padding's missing, there was a lot of scared individuals, including Marius Walk, and just stand there. Nobody wanted to be within 15 feet of the big man.
I could see that. I could see that. You know, it's like, you know, whoa. But, you know,
they have to implement something in boxing in general to make sure that this cannot take place.
Well, let me.
This is a tough sport. People get killed like that. You know what it'd be like getting hit with a wrapped hand with nothing but tape, you know, and the gauze on there without no padding and just a little thin layer of leather covering that. I mean, you do some serious, serious damage with that.
No, you're right. You know, the thing is this. I just want to make something clear to everyone. In my opinion, you know, the New York State Athletic Commission isn't bad in terms of the rules that are in place and everything else. It's actually one of the better, you know, commissions in terms of definition. You know, I've been around and have promoted fights in other states that, you know, talk about gloves. You know, the New York State Athletic Commission generally, at least the one that I dealt with, you know, would never allow some of these other gloves that I've seen permitted to be used in professional prize fights. But I do think that an error has been made, and I don't think that this current New York State Athletic Commission is following their own rules. I think they're kind of, you know, making rules up along the way. They're flexing their muscle. They're showing their power. And you happen to have a collection of individuals in there that are power hungry. They're all want to be Napoleon, you know, and I think that is the root of the problem. And it's that simple. You know, if these guys issued a statement and said, we made an error, we acknowledge our error, it won't happen again, I think it all goes away. And I think it's a better commission for, I would respect whoever sent the letter, whether it be Ralph or Melvina, I would respect them more at this stage. Even though it's 6 months down the road later, I would still respect them more for taking a responsibility now than just ignoring it the way they are.
And that's, you hit the nail on the head, and I have to agree 100%, is just, that's the, just admit your mistake, admit your fault, yeah, and let's move on. But if you're not going to admit your fault, there's no way that people can move on, and somebody's job has to go, because how many, you can't continue, you just can't continue on like this.
No,
you,
I agree. Cannot. Well, listen, brother, I'm looking forward to this whole story. I'm looking forward to closure. I really enjoyed the next piece that's up there. And keep me posted, my man.
And keep you posted. Little by little, it's all unfolding, and people are jumping out of the woodwork. And this is going to get, you know, to the point where they're going to be sorry. You know, they just, as you know, the old expression goes, you can only go around pushing so many people before that nobody you push turns out to be a somebody. Bryant Pappas turned out to be a somebody. That's a guy who wants to push back, no, and not just for himself. Yeah. And, you know, the commissioner's hurting themselves over it. But as we already know, they think they're untouchable. But New York is not boxing.
That's right. You're right about that, and I love that line in your piece. So, Daxx, let's talk later, my man.
All right, everybody. Have a great weekend. Enjoy the fights.
That's Daxx Khan. You can check out the newest installment of his Bryant Pappas / New York State Athletic Commission story. It's up on Billy C. Boxing right now. You can check it out under his column or right on the front page, either or. And like I said, you know, New York State Athletic Commission, in my opinion, bunch of bullies. But if they stood up and admitted that they did make a mistake and that they acknowledged that mistake, there's nothing else I would expect. You know, and I would gain a lot more respect for those people than I happen to have right now.
Now let's dig into our archives and hear a rare interview when Billy C. first became the champion of boxing talk radio. Hello, Billy C. As the new champ, can we ask you a few questions?
Why, certainly.
Okay, your fans would like to know how you and your corner have successfully walloped the competition.
We're not ordinary people. We're morons.
Anything else?
I'm a victim of circumstance.
Did your success finally come when you made the show 5 days a week for 2 hours? What do you think?
I'm trying to think, but nothing happens.
Now, please tell the listeners what you've learned from making it this far.
Certainly. If at first you don't succeed, keep on sucking till you do succeed.
Great words of wisdom, Billy C. Keep up the great work as the undisputed people's champion with your show, Talkin' Boxing with Billy C. Any last words to anyone who's listening?
This is your fault, you bonehead.
And we're back. You are listening to the Talkin' Boxing with Billy C. Show. You're watching us on the Fight Now television channel. Glad you could join us. What? You don't have Fight Now? You don't have Fight Now in your sports channel lineup? Well, you need to call your local television provider, whether it's satellite dish or cable, and tell them you want Fight Now right now. It's that simple. Pick up the phone and call for all the information about the channel. You can find it on their website, www.fightnow.com. Speaking of now, it's that time again. It's time for another heavyweight spotlight. I can't even talk this morning. Starring the man himself, Tony Treme. Good morning, Tony.
Good morning, Billy. C, how are you?
You're making me nervous. I can't even talk, you know? I mean, what is it? What you got your henchmen outside or what, man?
I've got my cigar lit, and I got my cup of coffee here, and I'm ready to rock and roll, dude.
There we go. We're doing another heavyweight spotlight, in case you guys have missed it. Tony and I talk about the heavyweight division and the history of the heavyweight division. And today, we decided to talk about a fighter that is virtually forgotten today. His name is Elmer Ray, and you know, he's in the history books, or at least some of them, as violent Elmer Ray. But even that's... well, it's up for debate. Why don't you tell us about this guy, man? Who was Elmer Ray?
Billy, this is an interesting guy. And the other day when you called me and you asked me if I knew of Elmer Ray and you wanted to talk about him, I thought, yeah, that'd be a good subject. And And as I got to looking around and things, there's a lot of things written on Elmer that, and different sources that don't make a lot of sense on him. You know, one source says one thing, another source says another thing. So it's going to be an interesting concept today, and I'm probably going to learn more than I tell the listeners about Elmer Ray.